Hello, I'm Paul Barton, and welcome to my piano tutorial on Rachmaninoff's Etude Tableau Opus 33, number 4, also known as number 5. Etude Tableau roughly translates as picture studies. The title tells us they started their musical life as a result of a picture Rachmaninoff had seen. He typically didn't give us much background detail about his work and is quoted in respect of the Etude Tableau. I don't believe in the artist that discloses too much of his images. Let them paint for themselves what it most suggests. Rachmaninoff, therefore, invites us to imagine what each picture could be for each work for ourselves. So, let's begin. Rachmaninoff wrote two sets of Etude Tableau, Opus 33, in 1911 and Opus 39 between 1916 and 17. Each set was to have 9 etudes. Just before the Opus 33 set went to the publishers, Rachmaninoff changed his mind about 3 of them, including D minor number 4, so wasn't included and was first published posthumously. Over time, some publishers stuck to the original publication and added the D minor in an appendix. Some publishers put all 9 back together, and in these editions D minor is number 4. Due to discrepancies between sequential numbering in scores and CDs, alternating between Opus 33 number 4 and Opus 33 number 5 give the best results in an online search. The tempo is marked moderato. It occasionally gets played at faster tempos, so for the purposes of this tutorial, the musical examples will reflect this, ranging from moderate to a little faster in that order. The first bar is a pickup bar, that's to say, a bar with the ghost rests removed. The first note, A, starts on the weak upbeat, we call the pickup beat, leading into the D on the strong downbeat. This pattern continues throughout the piece. The pickup bar generally doesn't count as a bar numerically. You start numbering bars from the first downbeat, so bar 1 starts from the D. And 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Bars 1 to 3 create a gentle bell-like resonance with a melodic interval of the fifth. I let the resonance ring until the entry of the first staccato chord. In the following musical examples, I have added extra dynamic markings to the score, according to the musical example played at any given time. In bars 1 to 3, I imagine a painting of a snowy winter Russian landscape, a troika standing still, waiting for passengers ready to set off on its journey. Staccato, indicated by a dot, changes the note's duration relative to its value. For example, this is how we write and play staccato in 2 crotchets and a minim. So bear this in mind as we go into the next section where theory and interpretation can blur at the edges. The staccato chords in bars 3 to 5 suggest to me the driver of the troika, passengers settled in, setting off in the snow. From standing, gradually picking up speed. staccato forzato gets a sharp percussive attack. The tenuto accent is made by pressing with weight. Bars 5 to 8 suggest the powerful feet of the three horses sinking through the soft snow to the hard frozen ground below. Due to the terrain, the driver slows them down, speeds them up, and slows them down again. Let's return to bars 1 to 3. We have two short phrases and a slur between the last two notes, A and D. In these three bars, we have three different uses for the curved line: to connect notes together in a phrase, to tie two notes together, and to slur two notes together in legato. Here's two suggested fingerings, changing the fingers on repeated notes. In bars 3 to 5, lift wrists during the rest between staccato chords. In bars 5 to 8, we have many things to think about simultaneously, quite apart from finding the notes themselves. This etude is crammed full of details. Practice slowly and attentively when learning the notes, so these details become ingrained from the start rather than add them later when you know the notes, as you can do with many other pieces. Be careful not to accent unaccented chords on either side of accented chords. Differentiate the various accents: staccato forzato, tenuto. Aim to join chords with slurs in full legato and notice which slurred notes have a stress. Contrast crescendo and diminuendo, writs and rejoining tempo. We can join tenuto chords an octave smoothly with the wrist and fingering, which contrasts with the staccato chords, like this. There's a question about voicing. A little more pressure on the upper note finds a melody, especially on the slurred notes highlighted. I'll run through this section again in a slightly different way to the previous example.
bars 19 and 13. The mood changes. It's brighter, I imagine, gliding smoothly through the snow, perhaps passing through a wood. Warm sunlight breaking through the trees, glistening on the frosted twigs and branches. Bars 9 to 13 have many hidden musical details, and it's fun to discover and find a way to play them. We have two main voices that sing together, contrasted with staccato chords. Here are the notes highlighted we want to sing out. Fingers need to hold melody notes while playing detached chords at the same time. In bars 9 and 10, the inner voices in both hands share the same notes, C, D, E, F, G, and A. They are a little out of step, but meet up twice in unison on the notes E and A. The essence of Chopin's Nouvelle Étude No. 3 is to develop the ability to play a legato melody against a staccato accompaniment at the same time with just one hand. In Chopin's Étude, it's the right hand. In Rachmaninoff's, it's both hands. To bring out the inner voices in Rachmaninoff's Étude, Chopin's Étude will be helpful to you. In these sections, we hold the melody note as long as we can and release the staccato notes around them at the same time. The staccato dot in this instance doesn't mean all the notes above or below it vertically are to be played staccato, just the accompaniment. The melody notes are to be held as in the Chopin Étude. The melody can't always be held as much as we'd like to, but we have the pedal, of course, to help out. With spread chords and leaps, the bottom note is to be played before the beat, the top note, often the melody note, on the beat. There's also the slurs to watch out for too, highlighted in orange. I'll play this section very slowly, and you'll see I occasionally play a note and hold it longer by transferring it to another finger. Playing Rachmaninoff's music is not an exact science, or is it meant to be? Also, rest assured, you don't have to have large hands to play this section well. Spread chords when you need to. Rachmaninoff's music, though composed with great care, has an improvisatory feel to it. Spreading chords can add colour and expression to the accompaniment. Thank you. In bars 13 to 17, I imagine our friendly old troika driver has spotted a black cat on the track and pulled his horses to a halt. The cat's interested in what's in that basket. Her cold paws step ever so lightly across the soft snow, watched patiently by the horse. He knows of all the hungry, cold creatures that roam the wilderness, this cat means them no harm. The troika sets off again, sun is shining and all is well. The second entry of the theme is much like the first. As we pick up the tempo after the writ, the repetition is to be played quietly instead of mezzo forte. We release the tension and gradually fade into that now familiar bell-like resonance. Clouds turn to gold, sudden short gusts of wind. The weather is changing. The inner voices are accented, a rising scale, then a falling scale. The yearning legato rising scale has staccato notes around it, slurs, stress notes, crescendos, diminuendos, so we need to practice it slowly. Suddenly, they find themselves caught in a blizzard. Driver passengers and horses do their best to brave the freezing snow and wind. The etude began with a melodic interval of the fifth, and this inner voice is based on this interval transposed three times. It reappears in bars 32 and 33. In bars 54 and 57, it's changed slightly to bring the piece to a conclusion. Each of the three times this melody appears, we need to make the most of it, as this etude overall is rhythmical and percussive and benefits when these inner voices can be heard clearly. We can accelerate a little as we build the crescendo, and when we get to bar 34 and the tension is released, we can have fun with the pedal or pedals. Hold on to that inner harmony in crotchets within the octaves, which are quavers and semiquavers. The octaves are played in staccato when indicated, while the inner fingers hold down the harmony. Notice there are no fortissimos in these bars. Resist the temptation to go all out too soon. Instead, keep something of the power of your piano for the fortissimo in bar 49. The climax of the piece will be more effective that way. Begin each slur with an impulse to join notes, with quick pedal releases in between slurs. This will better define the rhythm. Let's listen to a howl of wind. It seems to have a melody, then fades away. But soon the storm is over, all is still again on the horizon. Bars 34 to 38 are largely about pedals, resonance, and ways to isolate and prolong it with fingers. Notice C and B are held a little longer than the semiquavers above. We can prolong C by swapping over from thumb to fifth finger. Doing this with a B is possible but awkward. However, we want B to join with A. Notice the legato slur line that connects them. If your piano has two pedals, that's to say sustain and una corda, the staccato in bars 37 and 38 will
get a little lost. Not to worry, it still sounds atmospheric. If you have the sostenuto pedal in addition, you can hold the bass chords and play detached staccato. This piano has the fourth harmonic pedal, so we can hold the bass chords with the sostenuto part of it and play detached staccato with harmonic resonance. Here's a pedalling technique to prolong the C and B comfortably with the sustain pedal and one finger. Press the sustain pedal and play the bar. After the last quaver, press down C or B with the fifth finger. Note silently, which means pressing it down relatively slowly and without weight, so it doesn't sound. This has now caught the sustain on that note. Then release the pedal and hold the note sustain with the finger instead. The C or B will keep ringing. You can then release the C and join the B to the A. The Troika sets off on the final and most desolate stretch of the journey. Howls of distant wolves echo across the barren landscape. Horses, sensing danger, quicken their pace. In bars 39 to 44, the upper notes are held with the fifth finger, a finger we would otherwise use to play the double thirds below. As a result of this held upper note, the fingering available to us is awkward. We have two options. First option is to hold the upper note. The remaining fingers play the double thirds in staccato as best they can, as the mechanical process of the traditional sostenuto pedal is just too slow for this section. When staccato stops, we can use the sustain pedal, and in bars 44, we need to bring out the notes highlighted. Second option is the harmonic pedal. The design of the sostenuto built into it can capture notes or chords at a fast tempo, even multiple sostenuto layers simultaneously. The harmonic pedal can hold the long sustained bass chords and treble melody notes independently, which frees all the fingers to play the double thirds comfortably in detached staccato. This has not previously been possible. To activate the harmonic pedal sostenuto, simply press the pedal down and release halfway. It's like taking a photo. We press and release the pedal to capture a chord or note.
pack of hungry, snarling wolves surround them. The only chance of escape is to outrun them. We can hold the dotted crotchet octaves by sliding the first finger from the D sharp to the D to play this section at tempo. Avoid any unnecessary motion with the left hand. The octave chords can be played with 1 and 5, but there are several alternative fingerings. Tenuto accents are passed back and forth between the hands. To hold the bass crotchets with your fingers as well as sustain, we need to use the thumb to play the scale. At a fast tempo, this really isn't convenient, so you might need to release the chord to free up the fingers. We have marcato accents in the left hand, tenuto in the right. The marcato accents in this fortissimo section with a percussive attack will probably be the loudest notes of the etude, at least in intention. Rather than 16 semiquavers in a frantic blur, think four groups of four and be aware of the first chord in each group. Too fast for them, the wolves give up. Soon, the troika is nearing the end of its journey. The driver's friend rides out to greet them. There's something triumphant in these bars. I imagine the old troika driver galloping towards the town, gladdened to have delivered his passengers once again safely to their destination. Voice the top note of the melody in the right hand to contrast with staccato in the accompaniment. The right hand passes the melody to the left hand, three octaves below. To find and pick out in legato as best it can, voiced at the top of spread chords and large leaps, the lowest notes played before the beat. Again, staccato on all the accompanying notes around the melody. Thank you. They glimpse the brightly coloured domes far ahead. All arrived safely, their journey is over. We can hold the sustain pedal down to mix the bass and treble resonance right throughout the last three bars as the characters in our musical story become specks on the horizon. Now it's over to you to have fun working on this wonderful and challenging piece. And if you wish to, accept Rachmaninoff's invitation to let the music paint the pictures it most suggests to you, and, as it should, will be unique to each one of us. To end this tutorial, here's my recording of the entire piece with the score. So, if you're about to study Rachmaninoff's Etude, Tableau, Opus 33, number 4, or 5, which I hope you are, I hope you find this video useful. And thanks for watching.